a disclaimer for the viewers. So in this session, we are going to discuss the methods of preparation of liposomes. Preparation of liposomes. First of all, we will discuss the general method, how the liposomes are prepared. Already we have seen the mechanism of liposome formation. So let us see how actually it is prepared. So here I have given the general method of preparation. It comprises approximately the 7 steps, isn't it? So very first, that is a step 1, we have to supposed to dissolve the lipids 10 to 20 milligram per liter in a chloroform and the methanol mixture. So very first step, that is the dissolve the lipid in the organic solvent. Second step, remove the solvent by using rotary evaporator under reduced pressure to produce the thin film of lipids. So second step, that is the formation of a lipid film, isn't it? By removing the organic solvent by using the rotary evaporator. Third step, that is desiccate formed thin film for required time in order to remove the solvents from the film. Step 4, that is hydrate desiccated product for required time. So the fourth step, that is a hydration step. So in order to, there is a swelling of the phospholipids. So after complete hydration, the liposomes of multilamellar vesicles in the size range of 200 to 1000 nanometers are produced. So here at this step, we are getting the multilamellar vesicles, which is having a large size. Then in the step 5, reduce the multilamellar vesicles into the smaller liposome size by either sonication or the extrusion or any other suitable method. Then step 6, that is purify the resultant liposome. So whatever the contaminants are there, it needs to be removed from the liposomes. And the last step, that is analyze the final product. So these are the general steps which are widely used in the preparation of liposomes. Generally, drug, it is loaded in the step 1 or the step 4. If the drug is lipid soluble, then we have to suppose to dissolve the drug along with the lipids. Or if the drug is water soluble, it is to be dissolved into the hydrated buffer. So this is about the general method of preparation of the liposome. Once the liposomes are formed, we have to suppose to use the suitable method to reduce the size of the formed multilamellar vesicles. Let us see the methods of preparation and the drug loading of the liposome. There are 2 major methods are there. Well, first one, that is a passive loading methods, that is techniques, and active loading techniques. So in the case of passive loading techniques, very first one, that is a mechanical dispersion method, then solvent dispersion method, and detergent removal method. There are 3 methods are there in the passive loading technique. And in the case of active loading technique, that is a proliposomes and a lyophilization, which are used as a active loading technique. In the case of mechanical dispersion method, it is possible to prepare the liposomes by using the sonication, French pressure cell, that is extrusion, then freeze thaw liposomes, then the lipid film hydration by hand shaking or non-hand, then shaking or freeze drying, then micro emulsification, membrane extrusion, and dried reconstituted vesicles. So here, the membrane extrusion, then the sonication, and French pressure cell extrusion, these methods are used to reduce the size of the prepared vesicles. Then solvent dispersion method, it is possible to prepare the liposomes by the ethanol injection, ether injection, double emulsion, and reverse phase evaporation. Already we have discussed the general method for the preparation of the liposome. The same concept has been utilized here in the case of mechanical dispersion methods or the solvent dispersion methods with a little modification in the basic method. So let us see the details of the very first method, that is a passive loading techniques. So the passive loading techniques is to encapsulate the drug during the formation of liposome. So here the drug loading is done during the formulation itself. Either we have to suppose to incorporate the drug into the phospholipid solution, or we have to suppose to incorporate the drug into the aqueous solution, aqueous buffer solution. The hydrophilic drugs are loaded within the internal core of liposome by mixing with a hydrating buffer used to hydrate the thin film during the formation of liposome. Whereas the lipophilic drugs are mixed with the other liposome components during the preparation of thin dry film of lipids and ultimately loaded into the lipid bilayer. The unentrapped drug molecules are removed from the liposome suspension by dialysis or gel filtration chromatography. So here, once the drug loading drug gets loaded into the liposome, whatever the unentrapped drug is there, it can be removed by using the dialysis or the gel filtration chromatography. And size of the liposome, it is being reduced by using the suitable method. So this is about the passive loading technique. Very first method from the mechanical dispersion methods, that is the sonication. Sonication is generally used to reduce the size of the vesicle. It's the most widely used method for the preparation. Multilamellar vesicles are sonicated either with a bath type sonicator or a probe sonicator under a passive atmosphere. The main disadvantages of the sonication method when we are using the sonicator for the preparation of liposomes, that is very low internal volume to encapsulation efficiency. We are getting very low encapsulation efficiency. Then there may be the chances of possibility of degradation of phospholipid and compounds to be encapsulated due to the heat generation. Then elimination of large molecules like proteins and peptides. Then there may be the chances of metal pollution from the probe sonicator. Then the presence of the multilamellar vesicles along with the small unilaminar vesicles. So whatever the product we are getting at the end, when we are using the sonication methodology, it is a mixture of multilamellar and small unilamellar vesicles. Let us see the details of the probe sonication and the bath sonication. So very first one, that is a probe sonication. Look at the figure. So here, this is a probe sonicator. So this is the probe, which is made up of the titanium. Then here in the beaker, we have to suppose to take the prepared liposome and operate the equipment for the specific time period. So as to the size of the multilamellar vesicle, it is going to be reduced. More specifically, this is the apparatus. It is for the probe sonicator. This is the ice bath in order to maintain the temperature. This is a liposomal suspension. Here it's the nitrogen gas and this is a titanium probe. So the tip of the sonicator, it is directly engrossed into the liposomal dispersion. The energy input into the lipid dispersion is very high in this method due to the probe. The coupling energy at the tip of the probe sonicator results in a local hotness. So here there is a generation of heat and therefore the vessel must be engrossed into the water or the ice bath in order to maintain the temperature. Throughout the sonication up to 1 hour or more than 5% of lipids can be de-esterified. That is the main issue related with the probe sonication. There may be the de-esterification of the lipids due to generation of the heat. With the probe sonicator, the titanium, as this probe, it is made up of the titanium. So the titanium will slough off and pollute the solution. So this is about the probe sonication. Let us move towards the bath sonication. So this is the bath sonicator. So here, this is the vessel in which we have to suppose to place the liposomal suspension. This is the ice bath. And here it's a inert atmosphere. And at the end, we are getting the mixture of small unilamellar vesicle, then small multilamellar vesicle, and lipids, it is going to be aggregated at the bottom. So bath sonicator is like a big water bath. Look at the figure. The sample which is to be sonicated, that is dispersion of liposome, it is kept in the tube of the bath sonicator. The assembly comes with the temperature regulator. So here it's a temperature regulator, and thus maintaining the temperature of sample, it's easier. The high energy sound waves breaks the large multilamellar vesicles into the small unilamellar vesicle. But at the end, we are getting the mixture of the small unilamellar vesicle and the multilamellar vesicle. So this is about the bath sonication. So sonication technology, it is used to reduce the size of the prepared liposomes. Let us see the French pressure cell. Look at the figure. So this is the figure of French pressure cell. It comprises, this is a tube which consists of the piston. We are supposed to place the sample here, and which is forced, that is sample is forced through the small orifice, and thereby there is a reduction of the size of the liposomes. So the French pressure cell, it involves the extrusion of the multilamellar vesicles through the small orifice at a high pressure of 20,000 psi by using the piston at a temperature of 4 degrees Celsius. An important feature of French pressure vesicle method is that protein do not seem to be significantly proteinous during the procedure as they are in the sonication. As in the case of sonication, there might be generation of heat, and that may lead to the stability issues related with the protein and peptide type of the drug. So here, the heat is not generated, so it is possible to protect the drugs like proteins and peptides. French press vesicle appears to recall entrapped solutes significantly longer than SUVs do produced by sonication or the detergent removal. So the method involves the gentle handling of unstable materials, and method has several advantages over the sonication method, like the heat is not generated. But there are certain disadvantages, like we are getting the larger SUVs, then difficult to maintain the temperature, and working volumes in the French pressure cell, it is very low, that is a 50 ml. So this is about the French pressure cell. Let us see the membrane extrusion. So membrane extrusion, it is a yet another method which is used to reduce the size of the prepared liposomes. So this is another method of converting multilamellar liposomes into the unilamellar liposomes. The assembly comprises, this is the inlet. Then here it's a liposomal dispersion. This is a polycarbonate filter, and the material or the formulation, it is going to be filtered at the high pressure of 250 PSIG through the polycarbonate filter. And finally, we are getting the extruded liposomes. So in the membrane extrusion method, the multilamellar vesicles are made to pass through the membrane, which is made up of the polycarbonate under the high pressure around 250 PSI. The layers of multilamellar liposomes get peeled off until only one layered vesicle of small size are left. The disadvantages of the membrane extrusion method, that is high pressure is required, then not as effective as sonication, and produces relatively large vesicles. The advantages of the membrane extrusion method, it producing a liposomal population having a homogeneous size range and suitable to produce stable liposomes with a variety of lipid. So this is about the membrane extrusion method. Let us move towards The microemulsification method. Microemulsification method, it is a yet another methodology which is widely used in the industrial scale to prepare the liposome. So this is generally used for the preparing the SLVs, small vesicles. It can be achieved by microemulsifying the lipid composition using high shearing strength generated from the high pressure homogenizer. So this is the high pressure homogenizer which is used in the microemulsification method. So here we are utilizing the high pressure of 1200 PSIG. Here we are supposed to place the sample. Here there is an impact, shear force, then there is a cavitation, and finally we are getting the size of the liposomes in the range of 1 to 4 micrometer. This tube, it is having a diameter of the 70 micrometer and length that is 1 meter, isn't it? And the temperature which is maintained to minus 35 degrees Celsius. So this is about the microemulsification method.
So let us see the lipid hydration method. So in the case of lipid hydration method, it involves the 3 major steps. Very first step, that is preparing a dry film of lipid. That is the first step. So in the first step, we have to suppose to prepare the lipid organic solvent solution and get the dry film. That is the first step. The second step is hydration of lipid film. Add the buffer solution or the aqueous solution onto the lipid film and hydrate it for the sufficient time. And third step, reduce the size by using a suitable methods, whatever we have discussed previously, isn't it? So look at the figure. It is also known as the means hand shaking or the rotary evaporator. Sometimes the hand shaking is used to evaporate the organic solvent from the lipid solution in order to get the dry film. Sometimes the rotary evaporator, it is used to get the film. So here the first step is organic solvent containing the fatty acid. So we have to suppose to mix the fatty acids into the organic solvent and get the solution. Furthermore, evaporate the solution by using the rotary evaporator or the hand shaking so as to we will get the dry film onto the round bottom flask. So there is a formation of a dried film. Furthermore, add the buffer of appropriate pH in order to hydrate this film, in order to hydrate the dried film. So after specific time period, there is a formation of the vesicles in the hydrated buffer solution. If the drug is soluble in the buffer, we have to suppose to add the drug into the buffer solution. If the drug is soluble in the lipids, we have to suppose to add the drug into the along with the fatty acids and organic solvent in order to load into the vesicles. Furthermore, if required, reduce the size with the help of suitable methods like a sonication or French press cell or the extrusion. So this is the lipid hydration method. So in the case of lipid hydration method, there are the 3 steps are there. Very first one is preparing a dry film of lipid, hydration of lipid film, size reduction of the prepared large unilamellar or multilamellar liposomes. So in the case of step one, dissolve the lipids in a suitable organic solvents like chloroform or a mixture of chloroform and methanol. So here generally, the chloroform, it is used. Then step two, evaporate the solvent by using rotary evaporator in RBF, that is round bottom flask, so as to get a thin film of lipid. Step three, ensure complete removal of organic solvent by using a vacuum pump for a suitable period of time. This is step three. In the step four, add aqueous solvent like distilled water, saline solution buffer solution and non-electrolyte in RBF and agitate the solution for next 1 hour. Hydration step is done at the temperature above the gel liquid crystalline transition temperature of the solution. In step 5, after complete hydration, large and multilamellar vesicle forms in the RBF. Size of the liposome is reduced by using a suitable method, and the compound to be encapsulated are added either to aqueous buffer or the organic solvent depending upon their solubility in order to load into the prepared liposomes. So this is about the lipid hydration. Let us see the advantages and the disadvantages of lipid hydration method. So the lipid film hydration is the simplest method for preparation of liposome. This method does not involve any expensive or complicated equipment. It does not require maintenance of high pressure or the temperature as like the previous processes, whatever we have discussed. So the lipid film hydration is the simple method for preparation of liposome. This method does not involve any expensive or complicated equipment. It does not require maintenance of high pressure or the temperature. Let us see the disadvantages. Disadvantages of lipid hydration method are liposome formed are usually large unilamellar liposomes or the multilamellar vesicles. So here there is a need to reduce the size of the vesicle. Then encapsulation efficiency is low and liposomal population is heterogeneous in size. Whatever the size range is there, which is wide, isn't it? It is not a narrow range we are getting the liposomal size. So these two are the main disadvantages of the lipid hydration method. That is, the liposomes formed are usually large unilamellar liposomes or multilamellar liposomes, and encapsulation efficiency is low and liposomal population is heterogeneous in size. Let us see the certain modifications of lipid hydration method. So the lipid hydration method, it is further modified to dried reconstituted method and freeze-thawed method. So the modified methods are usually to improve the encapsulation efficiency, as in the case of lipid hydration method, as in the disadvantage, we have seen that there is a low encapsulation efficiency we are getting. So much of the drug, it is going to be lost during the manufacturing itself. So very first method, that is a dried reconstituted vesicle method. So in this method, as the name of the technique suggests, the liposomes are first freeze dried. So first of all, prepare the empty vesicles. Okay. Then mix it with the equal volume of solution of material to encapsulate, means drug solution. Initially, prepare the empty SUV, then mix it with the equal volume of solution of material to be encapsulated, then freeze dry it by using a freeze dryer in order to remove the water from the mixture, and furthermore, again, rehydrate in a controlled way. Add a very low volume first, that is 1/10 of initial. So as the name of the technique suggests, the liposomes are first freeze dried and are then reconstituted by adding the aqueous phase. So initially we have to suppose to prepare the SUV, right? Then add equal volume of solution which contains the drug, freeze dry it, and again rehydrate it. So as to will get the encapsulated product. The hydrophilic material that are to be encapsulated are added to the dispersion of small unilamellar vesicle, and then mixture is freeze dried. So this is the second step. In the next step, the freeze dried membrane is subjected to rehydration by dispersing the film stacks in a aqueous phase. This results in a formation of a uni or oligolamellar vesicles entrapping the hydrophilic material in their core. So this is about the dried reconstituted vesicle method. Let us see freeze thaw method. So in this, SUVs are rapidly frozen and thawed slowly. So look at the figure. So here the SUV in a aqueous phase, then the SUV with the solutes to be entrapped, whatever the drug is there, drug solution to be added into the SUV so as to will get the mixture of drug and SUV, then freeze dry it so as to will get the film or membrane. And furthermore, we have to suppose to increase the temperature of this film and furthermore sonicate it, isn't it? So as to will get the vesicle, final vesicles loaded with the drug. In this, SUVs are rapidly frozen and thawed slowly. The aqueous dispersion of small unilamellar liposomes is first freeze dried with the solutes to be entrapped. Means we have to suppose to prepare the SUV, right? Add the drug into it, and then the mass is then freeze dry it, and then the mass is slowly thawed. So thawing means the to make a frozen mass soft by warming it up. The repeated cycles of freezing and thawing increases the space between the consecutive bilayers. Next, the mass is subjected to sonication for further 15 to 30 seconds. The short cycles of sonication causes the dispersion of aggregated material into a large unilamellar vesicles. The large unilamellar vesicles are formed due to the fusion of a small unilamellar vesicle during the entire process of freezing and thawing. So this is about the freeze thaw method. So let us move towards the solvent dispersion method. Solvent dispersion methods are furthermore divided into the ether injection method, ethanol injection, double emulsification, and reverse phase evaporation. So in the solvent dispersion method, lipids are dissolved in a suitable organic solvent to make a homogeneous lipid solution. So in the case of ether injection, it is dissolved in the ether. In the case of ethanol, it is dissolved in the ethanol. In the second step, the lipid solution is added to excess aqueous phase, which contains the hydrophilic material which are to be encapsulated in the liposome. As a result of interaction of organic phase and aqueous phase, the lipid molecules align themselves at interface of the organic and aqueous phase and to form a single layer. This monolayer of a phospholipid contribute to formation of a bilayers of the liposome. So this is a general process or general concept related with the solvent dispersion methods. The solvent dispersion methods are furthermore divided into the ether injection method, ethanol injection, double emulsification, and reverse phase evaporation. Let us see the ether injection method. So in this process or in this method, a solution of lipid is dissolved in a diethyl ether or ether methanol mixture. It's gradually injected to an aqueous solution of material to be encapsulated at 55 degree to 65 degree Celsius under the reduced pressure. So this is a whole assembly, isn't it? Here, this is the aqueous phase. This is the assembly which is used to maintain the temperature. Then here, the solvent with the lipid, and there is a vent for the ether vapor, which gets removed from this flask, and slowly inject this ether solution into the aqueous phase. The temperature, it is maintained to 55 to 65 degrees Celsius. And finally, we will get the vesicles. The addition is done using a mechanical drive at an extremely slow rate, around 0.25 ml per minute. The consecutive removal of the ether under the vacuum leads to creation of the liposome. As the ether, it is going to be evaporated and there is a formation of the vesicle. The advantage of method, that is, it does not cause the oxidative degradation of the liposomes. The main disadvantage of the ether injection method, that is, the liposomal population formed, it is a heterogeneous size range between 70 to 200 nanometer, and compound which are to be encapsulated are exposed to organic solvents at high temperature. So this is about the ether injection method. Let us see the ethanol injection. Like a ether injection, the methodology is same. Only thing is that we are using the ethanol here, and the process is fast. Rapidly, we are injecting the ethanolic lipid solution into the aqueous phase. So whatever the lipid solution of ethanol is rapidly injected to huge excess buffer. The MLVs are formed at once into the aqueous phase. The ethanol injection method, it is simple and convenient. The sensitive lipids are at a low risk of degradation in the case of ethanol injection method. The disadvantage of ethanol injection method, the population is heterogeneous, that is the size which we are getting 30 to 110 nanometer. Liposomes are very dilute. The removal of ethanol, it is difficult because it forms into an azeotrope with the water, and the probability of various biological active macromolecules to inactivate in the presence of even low amounts of ethanol is very high. So this is about the ethanol injection method. The main difference in the ether injection and the ethanol injection, in the case of ether injection, whatever the lipid solution which is injected at a very slow rate, and in the case of the ethanol injection method, it is injected rapidly, isn't it? And at once the SUVs or the vesicles are formed into the aqueous buffer solution. So this is about the ethanol injection method. The next method, it is known as the double emulsification method. So here, which is based on the emulsion, that's why it is said to be the double emulsion method. So in this method, a aqueous solution containing a drug is dispersed in an organic solvent, which the lipids were dissolved in it, and creates the water in oil emulsion. Prepare the drug solution in water, then the lipid solution. Prepare the WbO type of emulsion. Then both phases are homogenized by proper agitation to form the primary emulsion, W1O. Then the primary emulsion is emulsified with the outer aqueous phase containing an appropriate stabilizer to form a double emulsion, W1O by W. That is W by O by W. The formation of double emulsion, that is particulate dispersion, is followed by evaporation of organic solvent, that is the internal phase, O, from the dispersion phase, leading to point of insolubility and consequently hardening of the polymer encapsulating the active material. So here, usually chloroform ether mixture is used as a solvent, which may be evaporated under reduced pressure through rotary evaporator or by simple stirring at ambient temperature, because they are having the low boiling point, depending on the boiling point of the organic solvent. So this is about the double emulsification evaporation. So we are preparing here the double emulsion in order to encapsulate the water soluble material. We are preparing W by O by W emulsion. Generally, the organic solvents like a chloroform and ether mixtures are used. Finally, whatever the chloroform ether mixture is there, which is present in the phase, it is evaporated in order to get the vesicle. The main advantage, unilamellar vesicles of a intermediate size are formed and theoretical entrapment yield is 100%. Here we are getting the maximum entrapment efficiency in the case of double emulsion evaporation method. Let us move towards the reverse phase evaporation method. The method is based on creation of inverted micelles. This technique is carried out by dissolving the lipids in an organic solvent, adding a small volume of aqueous phase so as we will get the W by O emulsion, then sonicating the solution to produce a inverted micelles. Look at the figure. So here two phase dispersion, W by O. So we have to suppose to sonicate it, we will get the one phase dispersion. And finally, evaporate the solvents in order to get the liposomes. Usually, diethyl ether or isopropyl ether or a mixture of isopropyl ether and chloroform is used as a organic phase. The organic solvent is removed by using rotary evaporator and a viscous gel is formed. Then this gel is mixed with a mechanical stirrer and thus forms the liposomes. The advantage of reverse phase evaporation method is the high encapsulation rate up to 50%. Small and large molecules such as RNA and various enzymes can be encapsulated by using the reverse phase evaporation method. The disadvantage, material to be encapsulated are made to come in contact with the organic solvents and the sonication cycles. So this is about the reverse phase evaporation method. Let us see the detergent removal method. That is a removal of non-encapsulated material. How to remove this non-encapsulated method? So in this method, detergents are first used to solubilize the molecules of phospholipid in an aqueous phase and then are removed to form a liposome suspension. That's why it is said to be the detergent removal method. So in this method, the detergents are first used to solubilize the molecules of phospholipid in an aqueous phase, and then the detergents are removed to form a liposomal suspension. When detergents are added to an aqueous solvent at a concentration above their CMC value, along with lipids, the detergents and the lipids form mixed micelles, where the hydrophilic part of the detergent molecules face towards the aqueous phase and their hydrophobic part covers the lipid molecule. The shielding lipid molecules form aqueous solvent. Removal of detergent is the critical step in the detergent removal method. So simply here we are using the detergents in the formation of the vesicle. When the detergents leave the solution, the micelles progressively become devoid of detergent molecules. And finally, the micelles, which are now made up entirely of phospholipid, combine together to form a large unilamellar vesicle. Initially, stabilization is done by using the detergents. Once the detergents gets removed from the system, there is a formation of the vesicles. The detergents can be removed by using the methods like dialysis, detergent absorption, or the gel permeation chromatography. So very first one, that is a dialysis. The detergents at their critical micelle concentration is used to solubilize the lipids. As detergent is detached, the micelle becomes increasingly better off in a phospholipid and lastly combined to form the LUV. Already we have seen previously. The detergents are removed by the dialysis. A commercial device called LipoPrep, which is widely used, which is a version of dialysis system, is obtainable for the elimination of detergents. The dialysis can be performed in the dialysis bags engrossed in a large detergent free buffers. So we have to suppose to place the solution into the dialysis bag, and whole dialysis bag it is placed into the buffer solution, equilibrium dialysis method, so as to remove the detergent from the system. The advantage, that is dialysis method of removing detergent, offers advantage of a good reproducibility, and liposome populations are homogeneous in size. Disadvantage, that is the main limitation of this method, is the inefficient removal of detergent, which may lead to retention of their traces in the liposome, and that may be the toxic. Detergent, let us see the detergent absorption. The detergent absorption is attained by shaking mixed micelle solution with a beaded organic polystyrene adsorbers such as XAD2 beads and BioBeads SM2. The great benefit of using detergent adsorbers is that they can eliminate detergents with a very low CMC, which are not entirely depleted. The advantage of detergent absorption is the elimination of detergents even with a very low CMC, which are not depleted completely. And disadvantage, additional detergents are required to carry out this process, that is detergent adsorption, removal of detergents by using a detergent adsorption. Then gel permeation chromatography, it is yet another technique which is used to remove the detergents. That is, detergents can also be removed by using a gel permeation chromatography, where the detergent is depleted by size spatial chromatography. You can say it as a size exclusion. The liposomes percolate through the spaces between the beads. Pre-treatment is essential, as the swollen polysaccharide beads would adsorb significant quantity of amphiphilic lipids. The pre-treatment can be done by saturating the gel filtration column prior to use with the lipids using blank liposome suspension. The column that can be used for gel filtration include the Cifadex G50, Cifadex G100, Cifaros 2B6B, and Cifacryl S200, S1000. Okay, so this is about the gel permeation chromatography in order to remove the detergents when we are using the detergent removal method. Let us see the size reduction of the liposome. As there are so many methods are there which are used to prepare the liposomes, and either we are getting the heterogeneous system, or the we are getting the large unilamellar or multilamellar vesicles. If you want to reduce the size of the prepared vesicles, which can be done by using the sonication, French pressure cell extrusion, or the membrane extrusion. And all these methods we have discussed previously, right? That is the active loading methods. So in the active loading techniques involves the loading of drug into the preformed empty liposomes. We have to suppose to formulate the empty liposomes, and the drug loading is to be done by using the pH gradient or the electric gradient or potential difference across the lipid membrane. We have to suppose to place these empty vesicles into the solution, and either the pH gradient it is exerted, or electric gradient, or the potential difference, which is responsible for loading of the drug into the vesicle. In active loading, several drugs such as the lipophilic amines are taken up and accumulated in the liposomes, which exhibit a membrane potential or the pH gradient. Active loading of drug through the pH gradient involves the preparation of liposome in a buffer having lower pH and then adjusting the external pH to 7 or higher. So automatically, due to the pH gradient, the drug is loaded into the core. Subsequently, the drug is added and the dispersion is incubated for a short period of time. The lipid bilayer is generally impermeable to the ionic molecules and the large hydrophilic moieties. The ion can be transported across the lipid bilayer by use of the ionophores, whereas that of the neutral and weakly hydrophobic molecules can be regulated by the concentration gradient. Amphipathic compound can be drawn inside the liposomes due to the difference in the proton concentration across the liposomal membrane. So this is about the active loading method. So here in the case of active loading method, the empty vesicles are used, and the active loading is done by using the principle of the pH gradient or electric gradient or potential difference across the lipid membrane or the concentration gradient, isn't it? So this is about the active loading methods. Let us see the advantages of active loading methods. Encapsulation efficiency and capacity is higher in the active loading method than the passive loading. Means in the case of passive loading, the wastage is more. Leakage of the encapsulated drug is less. Active loading gives freedom of using any type of lipid because the drug is loaded after the liposome formation. But in the case of passive loading, we have to suppose to use the specific lipid. Disadvantages of active loading methods are active loading techniques are not suitable for hydrophobic drugs. The aqueous solubility of drug is a major requirement for the efficient active loading. Means if we want to use the active loading method, whatever the drug is there, it should have the water solubility. Then and then only it is possible to use the active method. Active loading also requires presence of weakly basic functional groups in order to load into the vesicles. Only a few of the therapeutic agents possesses the characteristics which are necessary for active loading with the established technique. Active loading requires certain special conditions such as pH, electrostatic gradient, which will help the drug to cross the lipid membrane. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of the active loading methods.